The only reason why we worry is because we think we're smart enough to figure out the problem.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is.
And until we realize I'm not smart enough to run my own life and figure out my problems, we just keep doing it.
Hi, friends. This is Joyce Meyer's Talk It Out podcast, where Joyce teaches the Word of God in her practical, no-nonsense way. And my friends and I talk through the real stuff of living it and hold nothing back. I'm Ginger Stocky with Aaron Cluley and Jay Williams, three friends who are all in very different stages of life and know the importance of having honest, loving women around you. When we need a little extra help, we call it Miss Joyce and we ask her. Sometimes you need to talk about life with your girlfriend, so consider yourself one of us and let's talk it out. There, I said it real slow like that because I looked at Jay and she's mouthing every word that I say.
Let's
and it was a big
it out. So that was new.
No, I did that for you.
Yeah.
I like the way you threw me a bit of a curveball with that.
You need
one.
Your eyes nice okay. too.
Talk it out. Ginger does such a great job with that intro, and I'm always impressed with how she delivers it. So,
well, I'll tell you, the only thing that's really impressive is that I get through it with you girls here.
Kind of making fun of you on the side.
I don't know what you're talking
I don't
about.
Know how you do it. Honestly, if you all knew exactly what happens almost every single time Ginger does that open, like Aaron and I are like always giggling and like mimicking her, and she just powers through it.
Yep.
Professional.
Yep. It's what years of live TV does for you.
You are ready.
Nothing stops you. Nothing stops you. It does make me a little anxious sometimes, and we're talking about fear and anxiety. No,
I like
it really
the
does
way that
it.
You did that,
I know,
though.
That's called a transition. It's a lie.
Nice.
It was a total lie,
doesn't
but
matter.
It was a transition.
It was an excellent
you
transition.
You got us where we needed to go.
And honestly, I thought you were telling the truth, and I felt bad, low-key. I was like, I gave her anxiety.
No, don't feel bad. It wasn't true at all.
I'm like, oh, no.
Yeah, no, not true. But we did begin this topic last week, talking about fear and anxiety.
Yes,
if you
did.
Guys didn't hear last week's topic, go listen, because it was a good start to this, and I think where we all ended up was just kind of pouring out our souls. So now we need to pick up the pieces and figure out where do we go from here.
I can't pour anymore.
I know, man.
Got nothing
it's
left.
Like, it doesn't always happen when all three of us have some type of tear. And I know our producer, Ira, always is like super happy about that. He loves to see
Give
us.
Me more.
He's like, just speak from your soul.
I am nervous to actually listen to last week because I can only speak for myself. I was just so honest. Sometimes
You were great.
Well, thank you.
You really were.
Sometimes I forget it's not just the two of you sitting here, that all of our friends are doing this with us. And so it was a super honest moment for me. So I'm kind of nervous to.
And funny thing, I didn't listen to it either. Because I'm like, I don't want to listen. I don't want to listen to it, honestly. I will, but.
We'll do it. It was cool though, because I called my mom on the way home and shout out to my mom again. I have never felt such freedom after we did that day.
Really?
Like
That's awesome.
I could physically feel that weight of anxiety lifted off of me that day. Mm-hmm. And again, it's not an everyday thing where I feel that weight, but it's like I wasn't even thinking about what was going to happen 10 steps ahead of me. I was just in that moment and I was so wonderful. So talk.
That says a lot, doesn't
it? Does.
Like how talking it out with your friends.
Mm-hmm.
Is one of those things that really does help. What I did is I called my baby girl. I called my daughter, who is a psychologist.
Oh.
Yeah. And so.
What'd she say?
I'm asking her these questions. You know, what do people need to do? What, you know, how do we get past what we talked about into some of the answers? And she gave me some great advice that we'll be talking about a little bit. But one of the things was talk it out with your friends. Mm-hmm. That talking through it is so important.
It is.
Yeah. And that's why we're here.
Yeah. And that's so cool that even last week, if you haven't listened, which we just, you know, talked about that we didn't.
Yeah, but we admit that we have not.
Well, good job, Ginger. But if you haven't, please go back and listen, because Aaron does talk about how one of the things that about this that made it a little fearful for her was the fact that everything else she's talked about so far on the podcast has been, she's already somewhat overcome it, mm-hmm, but because mm-hmm. she hadn't overcome this yet, mm-hmm. and she was still going through it, it was a little daunting to even talk about anxiety yeah. or fear.
And absolutely. There's something about sharing the truth of it
yeah.
that takes the power away from it.
Yeah. It does.
It's not a secret anymore.
No.
And there's so much danger in our secrets.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And when we pour it out there, it not only gives us the chance to support one another,
yeah.
but it has that release in us that Erin was talking about.
It really does. I want so badly for all of you listening, all of our girlfriends, you can do this too.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not just
yeah.
me. Jesus is there with each one of us, and he will walk us through this together. So
yeah, my pastor always
listening.
Yeah, my pastor always says, you're only sick. You're only as sick as your secrets. And so
yeah.
Well, so let's dig into it. Let's see what the Bible has to say about fear, and Joyce is going to lead us in that.
I think we all probably have a lot more fear in our life than what we might even recognize. And usually, if you've got a big fear, like a heart pounding, you know, this is really, oh, I'm so afraid. You get that, you know. But I think there's a lot of little underlying fears that have been around for so long that we've just kind of gotten comfortable with them and don't even really recognize that they're there. How many of you think that could possibly be the case? And so I'm for let's be free from fear, okay? And you can't be free from anything that you don't recognize and learn how to deal with. And so then when you do recognize it, you got to confront it. You got to face it. One thing about fear is you cannot run from it and ever get away from it. That's what fear loves to do. It loves to chase you and watch you run. And what God wants us to do is confront things and deal with things and know that because he's with us, we can do anything, anytime, anywhere that we need to do. You're going to probably hear me say a good number of times this weekend, God is with you. That's the main reason the Bible gives for not being afraid. Fear not, for I am with you. I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. And some things we hear so much that we just get so used to hearing them that they don't mean to us what they should mean. And if you really take the time to stop throughout your day and think, now God is with me right now. God is with me in this. I'm never alone. God is with me. It becomes a greater conscious reality to you, and it starts to get really cool to realize that you and God are doing life together. Isn't that awesome? See, I don't know if you know this or not, but he doesn't just live in the church building. You don't just go see God on Sunday morning. You are the church. You are the temple of God. You are his building. And he lives in you. And he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Amen. Fear means to run from. The basic definition, if you look it up in Greek, means to take flight. To run from. And in another place in Hebrews, it says that we're not to shrink back in fear. So fear can cause us to shrink back. In other words, not to do what we know we're supposed to do or to say what we're supposed to say. How many times in life have we felt like we needed to talk to somebody about something and we really felt like we should do it, but we just say, well, I just don't like confrontation. Well, you know, just because you don't like something doesn't mean that you don't need to do it. We don't all like everything we do. That's why we need the Holy Spirit in us to show us what to do so we can courageously follow him. So courage is doing it afraid. Courage is doing what you know you should do, even though you might feel afraid. If you think that you're going to have a time in your life where you never, ever feel fear, you're sadly mistaken. You will feel fear at different times in your life until you're no longer in a human body, because that is the devil's number one weapon that he uses against God's people to keep them from their God-ordained destiny.
Do you girls think you have any fears that you've just kind of grown accustomed to, you've gotten too comfortable with?
Yeah, I do, actually.
Do you?
And I've said, it's just because, and this study has helped me with it, but one of the things I've talked about before was like the fear of man, you know, it's just...
That's a great one to talk about. Yes. We all have that.
Yeah, it's just like people's opinions or my boss's opinion or, and it's just something that I've grown accustomed to being like, if a task or something or if I have to approach something or confront something, just that nervousness that I get. And I just kind of always been like, oh, that's just nervous. You know, that's just me, you know, overthinking, you know, and but realizing that I can put into practice the same principles that we've been, that we're talking about, like, you know, acknowledging that it's fear and casting it out and, you know, and running to Jesus. We could do that even in those situations. But yeah, fear of man is one of those things that I can just easily see myself constantly doing because I'm always we're with people all the time.
Right.
So it's like,
they're really a part of
everywhere. Yeah, they're everywhere. You people are everywhere.
Yeah.
But yeah, so yeah, that's the one for me.
I'm going to second that. and raise you. No, I think you're right. I was actually thinking about that last week after you were talking too. I think probably that's what a lot of my fear comes down to is what other people think. Like, my perfectionism is because I don't want to mess up, because I don't want to let somebody down, because then they'll think I'm, I don't know, whatever. So I think that's a really good point, Jay.
Well, thank you, Erin. You're welcome. I am not feeling afraid of you right now.
Thank you.
Progress.
Progress.
We're getting somewhere. Yeah, that's interesting, though. I mean, that just it just made me really think about every part of my life.
It's that the ones that get me are... like fear of being late, fear of, like even today, like I had to adjust my schedule a little bit and I found myself like, cause some things were coming against me and I was like nervous, like, like, and I'm like, no. And I had to rebuke the enemy on even the way here. Like I was just like, I will not be afraid, you know, like God, you know that I'm doing the best that I can and I give it to you, you know? So I even had to put into practice this today.
Sure.
I was like,
well, like Joy said, it's with us. It means everywhere we go, you can't get away from fear.
Yeah, you can't. And so like, yeah, I felt that heart racing thing like, no, you know, like, no, you know?
Ginger,
that's why. That's why we all need a strategy.
Yeah.
I mean, I definitely agree with you guys. Fear of man, what people think, all of that is such a normal thing, I think, for all of us. What did they mean by that? You know? What are they thinking of me now?
Yeah.
Those types of things, those are huge. And so that is why we want to build a strategy. We want to talk about how do we allow God, because we know he wants to, how do we allow God to help us walk through those things? And I told you about this last week, but we still have, it's not too late, we still have a free download for you called Facing Fear and Moving Forward, where Joyce digs into the Word of God and what it says, and it's so helpful. It's at joycemeyer.org/talkitout. You can get that for free. And we want to be able to go those next steps. So when I start to fear that anxiety that you were talking about, you know, I'm going to be late. Everybody's waiting for me. And your heart starts to go, oh, no, what am I going to do? What? How do we handle that? And Jay, you said exactly you knew what to do. And we need that strategy. So we want to talk about building that. What do we need to have the tools in our hands so that we can fight back? So we have a lot of ideas, and I would just love to start by calling Joyce. Is that okay with you guys?
I think she knows a little bit about that.
She does.
She got a list of questions
to help this. Let's give her a call.
Hello.
Hi, Joyce. It's us.
Hey, how are you?
Are you ready to talk it out with us?
You know, I was just thinking a while ago, you guys call me to talk about something. I don't even know what you're going to...
Surprise!
Like, ready or not.
Love it. You just wait. We got a list.
I mentioned it to you, but it was a mention. And so you've got so much going on in your world. But the great thing,
really?
The great thing is we can throw out, we want to talk about monarch butterflies. And Joyce knows all about it.
I knew it.
Just so happens to be an expert.
No, we're
knew eventually you'd find something I couldn't talk about.
Right? We're talking about fear and anxiety. And we really want to help equip us and our friends with the tools that we need to fight back. Mm-hmm. So when we start to feel that anxiety building up and those fears, what are the things that you suggest that we have at our ready to fight?
Obviously, if you don't know the word, then you're going to have no tools to fight with.
Right.
But if you know the word, then the best thing to do is start confessing scriptures that where Jesus promises us that we can have peace. And I think our first line of defense for anything like that is always to pray right away. I don't know, people sometimes say, well, I guess there's nothing left to do but pray, which is a silly statement because that should always be the first thing that we do, mm-hmm. is pray. And
so with
I
that,
know myself, I'll have worry attack me about different things, and I do exactly what I'm suggesting to you right now. The first thing I do is pray, and then I remember that I have peace, and it's up to me if I want to trust God and let Him take care of it, or if I want to worry about it all day.
So because we're kind of a drive-through society, and we want instant answers, and we want to know exactly how to do it, I think a lot of people are going to be saying, what do I pray? Is there a certain thing that you need to say or ask for, or is it just calling out the name of Jesus? So what is that prayer like for you?
Well, if I start to get worried about something, I'll just say, Lord, I don't want to worry about this. I know that's not your will. That's not pleasing to you. And I know it's not going to do me any good.
Yeah.
It's going to be useless. And so I cast the care of this on you, and I trust you to take care of it. And, let's say maybe the same thought comes back in 5 more minutes. Well, I might have to do it again. Mm-hmm. I might have to. Sometimes you have to let the devil know where you stand. Scripture is always our top line of defense. I looked up Hebrews 4:12 just to look at it and read it to remind myself of just how powerful the word is. And it says, I don't know if I can quote it exactly, but it says the word of God is sharp and powerful like a two-edged sword. Mm-hmm. And it divides soul and spirit. When you start reading and studying the word, you really can't continue in sin without being convicted, because the word convicts you of what's right and what's wrong. And so the word of God has power in it. It's like, that's probably one of the hardest things for people to really understand, is when we say study the word or confess the word, it's God's word is different than any other kind of word. His word is full of power. And that's one thing that Satan is very much afraid of, is the word of God, the name of Jesus, and the blood of Jesus. Something that I've found that's very helpful to me is I just have to have a lot of conversations with myself. Sometimes I just simply say, this is stupid. It's not going to do any good. Mm-hmm. Matter of fact, I had something come up just before you called that could be a tense situation. And I just right away said, Lord, I ask you to help me take care of this where it's easy. And prayer really is the most powerful tool that we have, especially if you fill your prayers full of God's word.
Yeah.
I love what you say about confessing the word. And I have pulled a confession list on, if I face anxiety, here's the scriptures I'm going to quote on peace and all of that stuff. So what do you do though, when I'm saying my scriptures, I'm believing that God is going to take this from me, and I don't feel it. I still feel that anxiety and that heart racing. How do I, one, stop it and not let that make me feel defeated, like I'm doing it wrong, or I don't know God enough that I'm failing in that area?
Well, first of all, an all full-out panic attack is different than just
Sure, sure.
Worrying about something. You know, you get physical things involved in that could possibly need some kind of medical attention. But if we're just talking about normal day-to-day worry.
Yeah.
I mean, I have a statement that I say, if you're going to live by your feelings, you might as well just stamp across your life destroyed. Mm-hmm. Because we can't, you know, we can't control what we feel, but we can control what we do.
Yeah.
And so I always feel like if I continue to do the right thing, my feelings will catch up with my decision. Mm-hmm. So I can't promise anybody that they're going to pray one prayer and all their feelings are going to go away. And I cannot explain why some prayers are answered right away and others, you may be praying the same thing 5-10 years before you see a breakthrough. All I know to do, and all I can tell anybody, is to do what the Word of God tells you to do. Mm-hmm. And I believe that there's a promise that the faithful, and this whole the whole matter about fear really are worry and anxiety. It's all a matter of trusting God. Do I trust God or do I trust myself to take care of this? And I think that a large part of it is just having experience with God. It's so much easier for me to trust God now than it was even 10 years ago because every year that I live, I have more experience with watching God work in my life. And, you know, I went for a period of time where I felt like I had all kinds of prayers out there that I wasn't seeing any breakthrough to at all. And then all of a sudden in the last week, I've seen like 4 of those prayers answered.
that's cool.
So, you know, those are exciting times.
Yeah.
The other times are testing times.
Yeah. Well, Joyce, I want to personally thank you for being such a general in the faith that is just so honest and transparent.
Yeah.
Because it's comforting on this side, you know, to know that there is hope, you know, and to hear because I came from a church mentality that, you know, the people on from the platform had it all together. They got it all together, you know, and.
Or did they?
I know. Yeah, exactly. And so.
No, they didn't.
But that was the perception that I had looking up to them. But I think it's so comforting for, I know myself and I believe everybody listening to hear, even you say, like, even today I worried about something, but I use these tools and it caused me, you know, to have peace in God and remind, I have to have those snapback reminders of, you know, God, hey, wait, you're in control. It's going to waste my time to worry about this. It just is so, it brings a sense of humanity, like of peace, you know, like in a peace to say like, ooh, like I'm not by myself. Like this isn't, I'm not, like you said, Aaron, it's not like I'm not a good enough Christian. You know, I'm going to face this fear, these fears, you know, forever, but I have the tools to overcome it. So I just want to thank you for that.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Well, you're welcome. You know, like the situation I'm talking about, I know that I will have to deal with some things. I will have to go through some things, you know, talk to a few people who may not all feel the same way about it. You know, there's nothing worse than being in the middle of a bunch of people when you love them all the same and you have to make a decision that is probably not going to make everybody happy.
Yeah, that is scary.
Yeah. It is.
That's a rough that's a rough position to be in. But I do know, and I know this, it will work out, and it will pass.
Yeah.
One way or the other. Even if somebody gets mad, they'll get over it. And,
yeah.
You know, maybe nobody will. I think a lot of times we think the worst before we even wait to see what's going to happen.
That's an excellent point. Yeah.
Most of the things we fear, the fear of them is actually worse.
It is.
Than the going through it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think sometimes that realization that it's not all in your control anyway. Like you said, some people may get mad. They may not. You do your best and you trust God that He takes care of it because it's not in your control anyway.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, you can only do... All I can do is what I think is right, and then everybody else has to decide for themselves how they're going to behave. That's between them and God.
Yeah. Do you still do stuff afraid every day?
In this situation that I'm talking about, you know, sure, there's a little bit of fear there that I, you know, am I going to make somebody mad? Am I going to, you know, end up hurting feelings? But you still have to do it, and so... You know, the only way to deal with fear is to confront it. I mean, you can't run from it because it loves to chase you.
Hmm.
And but if you confront it and go through it, that's the only way to conquer it. And so I think a good thing to remember is this will come to an end. Everything, no matter what you're going through, it will eventually come to an end. And I know these things aren't easy. There's probably... Sometimes I feel like it's almost useless to tell people not to worry because it's something that they have to come to themselves that they're going to trust God more than themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really what it comes down to. The only reason why we worry is because we think we're smart enough to figure out the problem.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is.
And until we realize I'm not smart enough to run my own life and figure out my problems, we just keep doing it. You know, you preach the same messages over and over and over, and people still need them and still like them because there's certain things that we just have a tendency to always fall back into.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Joyce. We really appreciate the help.
You can call me whenever, and if you catch me, I'll be glad to.
We will. We caught you today.
Hey, I'm going to go quick study up on butterflies.
Perfect. That will be the next podcast topic.
All right. Great.
Love you. Thanks.
Love you. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. You know, she's talking about fear chasing you.
Mm-hmm.
And it just made me see this image in my head. We used to go to the beach every year and we'd take friends with us. So there'd be a bunch of kids. And on the beach, there were these great big bumblebees, like, I don't know, the size of a half dollar. Mm. They were huge. Mm. And they would, the kids would run from them, and the bees would chase them all over the beach. And those parents, we would sit and laugh. Because
what great parents you are.
I know. Because these bees didn't sting.
Oh,
so
wow.
The bees would not hurt them. And if they stopped running, the bees would stop and fly away. And we would say, stop running. They're not going to hurt you. But the fear was greater than the truth. So the kids would run anyway, and the bees would continue to chase them. But
that's what I look like.
No, but it's
stop
like Joyce
running,
was saying, sometimes the fear of what's going to happen is far worse than reality. Because when they did stop, the bees went, oh, shoot, the game's over. And then they flew away. And no one ever got hurt. So,
yeah, that's so real, because that's something I think I've talked about too before, is when I would have those fears of like confrontation or just handling something, or this is something I know I got from my father, because he would sometimes say things and it would be like a conversation that we thought he had already had, but he hadn't had it yet. And he's like, and he said, and this person said, and so that's a habit that I noticed that I had picked up.
Like you've already thought it out in your head.
Yes, which is so not cool. So if I knew I had to do something, I'd be like, and if I knew I had to have a conversation with someone, and then she said, and it's like,
but it hadn't happened
yet. Did you
yet.
Have the conversation? No. That's a bad thing.
Yeah.
Like, but I've noticed several people that do that. I'm like, have you ever had the conversation yet? No, I just pretty much know what they'll say. Uh-huh, you really don't. So breaking that habit, like, you know, and stop running, because the bee might not even sting. It might turn out totally different. It may turn out the way that you thought. And in those situations, you like to have to be like Joyce said, like, give it to God and just be like, you know what? That's on them, on how they receive it. And it is what it is. But
I think one thing that's been super helpful to me walking through all this is Joyce's Battlefield of the Mind book, because it really does all come back to our thoughts. And so when you're saying that, like, you're having, you're five steps ahead in your mind of what this conversation has been, even though you haven't had it yet. You have to think about what you're thinking about. Like, you can stop that internal mind conversation that's being had and nip it in the bud before you get yourself all anxious, anxious and worried.
You know, Erin, I think she said something really important for you too, and that's,
she probably did.
That
I wrote it down. So many things.
That fact that the fear and anxiety, when it gets to a point that you have a physical response and your heart is racing and whatever else you're dealing with, you're not breathing right. That is a different type of response. That, you know, when it does become physical, it's not about not being a good enough Christian. And so many times when that happens to people, they feel like I'm broken. And that's not true. It's like anything else that you would deal with physically. You have to handle it in a different physical way. And that's one of the things that I was talking to my daughter Morgan about, and she was giving some suggestions when people are dealing with that. And she said, you know, one of the things is you have to begin breathing differently, and you have to ground yourself. And if you look it up online, there are a lot of grounding exercises that you can do, but it essentially takes the emotion out of it. So you start using all your different senses. What do I see? What do I hear? You know, find five things that I can see. So there are a lot of physical, practical ways that will help as you're dealing with that. And I love this, because she also said to make sure that you have something that is a quick response on hand. So keep it on your phone, keep it in your pocket, but have the Word of God, have a scripture, have a song in your mind that you can begin singing worship songs or whatever it is. Have some sort of an affirmation of who you are in Christ, that you can trust Him. Having those things ready not only works in the spiritual realm, because what Joyce was saying about the power in God's Word, but it also focuses your mind in a different way.
It does.
So there are so many things like that, that, and you know, many, many more, because I'm certainly no expert. I'm just leaning on her and making up stuff. But
that's encouraging. I feel so much more prepared.
But really, to remember, this will pass. This too will pass. And that it's not happening because my faith is not good enough.
I
think that's really important.
I think it's really cool. And one of the things, and you all don't have to do this, but I typically keep like essential oils near me, you know, like certain essential oils even help me, like when I just rub it on my hands and like as I'm taking
that's
a deep breath,
idea.
You know,
it's
like breath,
calming.
Like even like lavender or something like eucalyptus, something that's spa like, because my happy place is
the spa.
I like to call those J days. And if I can't escape and go to the spa, because I do know when
we love J days too.
I love myself.
Like if I post on my Instagram or something that I'm at a massage place, like Ginger and Erin will both text me like, ooh, a J day. But those are things that I've learned throughout the years, that those are important for me. Like when I feel myself feeling like the pile up of anxiety, or I feel those heart palpitations more, I do run to the Lord. But there are some practical things, like Joyce even said, some things might need medical attention. Don't ignore those signs. But
for sure,
I know sometimes I need to get a massage, or I need to smell lavender.
When I can feel that fear, anxiety coming, I turn off my social media.
Oh, yeah.
I won't go to it, because I think a lot of what stems from is I see what's happening, or I don't want to miss out, and I don't want to, you know, FOMO. I don't want that.
Yeah.
Or I'm not comparing or something. And so that, I can feel that in me sometimes cause fear or anxiety. So when if I turn that off, that makes a huge difference. So that's been one thing that
I've
been really helpful. You don't need to know what's happening.
Isn't it crazy how the enemy has like made like things that that the Bible clearly tells us to cast out, like trendy. Mm. Like we have to be, mm-hmm. we have to be careful of that. Mm-hmm. And that, I mean, I'm not trying to be like super spiritual and extra Christian-y,
right.
but like yeah. FOMO is something that like my teenage daughter says, like mm-hmm. that's like a trendy word now.
Like, so I'm cool. Like
the
Caitlin.
Enemy's so slick with it. Yeah, yeah. FOMO really stands for fear of missing out.
Yeah.
He's a mate. Like, oh, he comes as a roaring lion. He's a sneaky little sucker and he's defeated.
Right.
And we have to acknowledge that stuff yep. and not let that stuff sink in. So that's really good.
Because once
you
acknowledge it, then it takes away some of that power.
Exactly.
And yep.
well, yeah, you're exactly right. I love these ideas. I think they're great. They're practical and they're spiritual because we are
yeah.
body,
absolutely.
Soul, and spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And they all have to go together. And so use these things. It's a strategy for you to be able to combat those things that you're experiencing. And like Joyce says, don't stamp defeated on your forehead.
Yeah.
You know, don't live in these feelings. I love this. It's in Lamentations. And you think, Lamentations?
It's not every day
not
you get a
good
who wants to go there?
In the good book of Lamentations.
But that's why it's like David's writing all of these terrible things, his lamentations, all those things that he's fearful of and worried about. And then in chapter 3, starting in verse 21, it says, "But I call this to mind, and therefore I have hope. The mm. steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness." Mm. And he goes on and says, "The Lord is my portion," and everything that he needs. In the middle of our lamentations, we need to remember that it's not our strength that carries us through, that the Lord is our portion, that he will yeah. never fail us, he will never leave us, and hold on to those truths.
Yeah, that reminds me of one of my favorite scriptures, which is 1 John 4:18, how it says that perfect love casts out fear.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so that scripture just triggered me to think about that.
Yeah.
Like whenever I'm feeling fear, I notice that there's a deficiency of my love tank being full, and not because it's not available.
Yeah.
It's just because I haven't just taken my portion in, just received it, like, you know, like allowed God to
yeah.
push it out. Like God is so gentle and so kind. Mm-hmm. Holy Spirit is so loving and kind that I have to like acknowledge, hey, there's fear here. And so that means that I need more of the love of Jesus.
More in the love tank.
Yeah,
I like that.
More mm-hmm. of my love
pull
tank.
Pull up to the love gas station.
Yeah, fill
the
her
love
up.
Shack,
fill
baby.
The love shack. Fill her up. But you know, and so I have to seriously like stop, take a deep breath, probably a whiff of lavender, but also
yeah.
like, but say like, you know, God, fill me up.
Mm-hmm.
Fill me up. Because when I'm full of you, that perfect love casts out fear.
Mm-hmm.
It's nothing I have to do. Like, I don't have to cast it out. I don't have to push it out. I don't even have to honestly rebuke it out. It's just like, if I'm full of God, his love just casts it out.
There's no room.
There's
yeah,
no room
really
for
good.
It. So, yeah.
Okay, since we're sharing scriptures that mean something to us. Mine is 2 Timothy 1. That's true. I mean, yes, 2 Timothy. So 2 Timothy 1:7 is God did not give us a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mm-hmm. mind. My dad taught that to me when I was little. And before I'd go to bed, we would work on it, like, words at
yeah.
a time because I was little. So it's always meant a lot to me. But I was reading it yesterday, and one of the things in 2 Timothy 1, it's talking about how, and I wrote this for myself, God has called me not because of what I can do or earn, but because of his own purposes. And that was being shared
That's
with Timothy.
Great, yeah.
And so my fears are not important because God's not calling me because of my own strength or my own
yeah.
perfection. It's because of what he can do in my weakness. So it's like what you're saying. It's renewing myself on
yeah.
who I am.
Mm-hmm.
And then it, yeah, casts that fear out.
That just fills yeah. you with peace.
Yeah. Man, that Bible is good stuff.
It's good. I used to have Taylor quote that one. And she used
yeah.
to be like, God not give me spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound my mind. She always had my in there. Sound my mind.
That's so cute. Oh, that's so sweet. How we remember those things when we're kids.
Yeah.
I still remember the little scripture song. I can do all things, all things, all things. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me.
I don't know that
13.
We need more of those.
They're good.
Oh, they're the best.
You know, that's another thing that I was thinking about too, is just my kids. I don't want to pass my fear along to them.
Yeah.
I don't want them to see my mom didn't let me do stuff because she was afraid. Or
mm-hmm.
and I consider myself a strong woman. I I am independent and I know who I am.
Yeah.
But I will not let my fears hold my kids back.
Yeah.
So
that's so important. And a perfect ending transition.
Man, that's twice today.
Because next week we're going to talk about what it means to be a strong woman.
Ooh, that was so good.
She didn't even know she was doing that. She's so good.
That's how good I am.
Well, we are so grateful that you have all been with us and that we've been able to sit down and talk it out together and that we've built this strategy. I hope that you all are taking bits and pieces of what we've said. Dig into God's word. Pull out those things that will encourage and strengthen you. Have those things at hand when you're experiencing fear. And we're just praying and believing that God's going to do wonderful things as you fight that fear, but also do it afraid when you need to.
Yeah. Make sure you go ahead and write that stuff out too. Mm-hmm. Like we are talking about our battle strategy, but go ahead and write out what do you plan to do?
Yep.
Like when Taylor had asthma, it was like, we had a plan of action, you know? So what is your plan of action when that fear arises? You know, so write that thing out and put it on a post-it or put it on your phone and use that bad boy.
Yeah. I will say after having done that, that's when I've seen the most changes is because I knew what to do. I knew my go-to was.
Mm-hmm. That's great.
So
good
idea.
All right. Well, we will see you all right back here next week. Don't forget joycemeyer.org/talkitout to get the resources we've been talking about. Hashtag talk it out, girls, when you're on social media, but not when you're not supposed to be, because that's what Aaron just talked about. If it's giving you anxiety, don't do it. But if you are doing it, use hashtag talk it out, girls.
That was like all in one breath.
It was.
And sign up for our email subscription because you'll get some really great resources there. Okay. We love you all. We'll talk next time. Bye.
Bye, friends.